It's 4 o'clock in Radio Cairo. This is World of Info. So this is World of Info, and we're coming live directly from Studio 3. My name is Dr. Amr Mabrouk, and Dua Muhammad is at the control. And today we have a very distinguished guest with us, His Excellency Ambassador Hong Jin-wook, the Ambassador of Republic of Korea in Egypt, a distinguished diplomat who served as the Director General of Africa and Middle East before he came here to Egypt in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And before that, he was the DCM of the Korean Embassy in Rome, and before that served in New Zealand, Kenya, and Brussels, with a degree in economics, a master degree in economics from California, and a degree in economics as well from the National University of Seoul. A very distinguished, bright gentleman, and we are very proud to have him here serving in Egypt as the Ambassador of Korea here. So we are coming live from Studio 3. Our direct line number is 257-89407, and we are pleased to have with us the distinguished Ambassador, Mr. Hong Jin-wook, the Ambassador of Korea in Cairo. Thank you very much, sir, for taking the time to come with us here in our studio here in Radio Cairo.
Thank you for your kind invitation.
It's a great pleasure and honor to have you with us, and we are here to talk about the Republic of Korea. I think we owe a lot to Korea and Korean people in their persistence and their perseverance in what they have done, or almost like a miracle, what they have done as regards the economic rise. I mean, it was rising as a phoenix. The world has witnessed the economic miracle on the Han River. How was that possible after a devastating war of 1950 onwards till 1953 to find a country that is almost coming out of ashes, a country that has been subjected to Japanese occupation for a very long period from the 19th century onwards, continuously, although it was a site of a kingdom or three kingdoms, and these three kingdoms had their own fights, had their own unification, and yet had their own culture that helped the perseverance and persistence. How could Korea rise out of ashes?
Yes, Doctor. I feel thrilled by the very extensive knowledge of yours on the Korean history, modern and ancient. And thank you very much for the very positive assessment of the Korean economy in calling it a miracle of the Han River. And I do agree with you in calling it a kind of miracle. Yes, indeed, it was a miracle. And firstly, so far, Korea has been the only country who transformed itself from a beneficiary of international system to a decent donor of it. Never in the world history, no country was able to transform itself from beneficiary to a donor of international assistance.
And this is, this is really admirable, because when we look at the history, we were just talking about 1943, the Cairo Declaration, which is a declaration that the victors, or the expected victors of the war, they here met here in Cairo, the Russians, the Soviets, the Americans, and the British decided that
China. Not the Soviet Union.
Yes,
at the time.
Chiang Kai-shek regime. And of course, the British and the Americans, they decided that they were deciding actually on the fate of Korea, and yes, the Koreans were outside, unfortunately, this declaration of 1943, and they they said that they would divide Korea and things like that.
Exactly.
This was a day to remember, a year to remember, and from people who were their fate was determined by superpowers, to a country that is almost a superpower of economics, and a war, the devastating war along the 38th parallel. Still, we are very anxious to know what made this thing or this miracle happen.
Mm-hmm. Yes, of course, we go for that. And if we briefly look at the sort of world standing of the Korean economy to remind our listeners that Korea is still developing. I can introduce you a couple of figures for that. Korea is, as you may be aware, 12th largest economy in the world and around the 7th largest exporter in the world. And Dr. Mabrouk, have you ever heard of the existence of Club 30, 50 group of countries, yes. What we call club 30, 50 is a group of nations with a population of greater than 50 million,
mm-hmm.
and also together with a per capita GDP, gross domestic products, of higher than $30,000 per year.
Yes. And this was the target of General Park in the 60s. He said that in the beginning there was a $100 income for the Korean at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And he said he promised that he would change the Korea to 1,000 in the 70s mm-hmm. millennium, and then onwards, every 10 years, you will find yourself. And in 2020, the Koreans were supposed to have $20,000 income, right?
Right. So there are only 7 countries mm-hmm. who are members of what you call Club 30-50.
Mm-hmm.
United States, Japan, UK, France, Germany, Italy, and Korea. There are mm-hmm. only 7 nations in the world who got titled to be a member of
the magnificent, the Magnificent Seven, right?
I'd like to say so.
Yes, definitely. So Korea was able to find such a place, although it was a country that people looked on it with a lot of pity, and examining the miserable situation that after a terrible occupation by Imperial Japan, because Imperial Japan is different than Japan of today, of course, Imperial Japan, and of course a conflicting war that really has left a lot of every family in Korea has lost a person or a family member at least in this conflict, and every person or every household has seen a devastating economic condition after this war that went on from 1950 to 1953 with no real end or light in the end of the tunnel. So How were you able to change this misery in such a member of G7?
Of course, as long as we call it a miracle, we are not able to exactly explain what happened during the past. However, experts say there are several factors for the Korea success, starting from the hardworking spirit of all Korean people. And secondly, continuous investment in education and R&D, research and development, was made all throughout the history. And also, I would say, proper governmental policies for economic development. And also, in some part, some favorable external environment coming out of the Cold War, the confrontation between the United States and Soviet Union at the time, did contribute a little bit to the success of the Korean economy. If I give you some detailed explanation, for hardworking spirit, every students and workers in Korea, they have been open spending the night, sacrificing their present for better life in the future, better life of their future and their family. This is a kind of top secret between you and me, but we do have a kind of fighting spirit to defeat, to win over our neighboring countries like China or Japan. Every Korean people has a strong willingness to win over our neighboring nations. This kind of fighting spirit did contribute to the economic development story of Korea.
So when we're talking about economic development, as you have just mentioned, sir, and touched the education, and I think that the secret of success of education prevalence in Korea and the lack of illiteracy was simply the 14th century, the discovery of the Korean, or the invention of the Korean alphabet, which made life easier, much easier for any student or any pupil who wants to get an education. He would be able to find an easy language to deal with. And after that, the sky is the limit for the education. So, should we start in the 14th century, or should we go to the famous mothers of Korea?
The problem is that, Doctor, you know much more about Korea than I.
No, myself. Sir. Actually, no.
So it's up to you. You are the master of the segment. I follow.
No. I'm sorry.
Certainly, Korea has a very wonderful, user-friendly language, as well as very unique writing system, what you call Hangul, which was invented by the Korean king Sejong in the exactly in the 15th century. Of course, that was one of the factors for the very low illiteracy ratio of the Korean people so far. However, seeing from the fact that, as you rightly mentioned, between the 1910 and 1945, we were under Japanese colonialism at the time. Definitely, they are very much different from the current Japan and Japanese France, of course. During the time, our Korean illiteracy ratio was as high as 78%.
Wow.
Now it's only 1%, meaning, of course, we owe something to the very scientific and very user-friendly language and writing system of Korea. However, there has been something much more than that who contributed to the successful education of the Korean people. And the I would say definitely it should start from the passion of the Korean parents to educate their children to the past, to the best. You know, they are sacrificing everything for the better education of their children. For example, they don't eat good things, they don't wear good uniforms, they just save their money for better education of their children. And the children, their children, under the influence of the Confucian culture, they are very much obedient to the instruction from
to the hierarchy, parents,
to the hierarchies, and also they, almost all of them are very faithful in following the instructions or from advices from their parents. So they just study very hard in order to secure their better life in the future. And as Korean teachers, they are also very much committed to teaching their children, their student, to the top level. That is why once former American President Barack Obama, praised very highly of the Korean education system, referring examples. He actually mentioned at a speech, I don't remember the exact occasion of his speech, but he had a speech made public when he was president. He mentioned that American students are spending almost 1 month less in their classrooms than their Korean counterparts. And also, he referred very good tradition for Korea to pay respect to the teachers who are in the very center of providing very good education to the student. Without respect for those teachers, they are not willing to actually contribute whole of their life to the education of the Korean student. So he refer those two conspicuous experience by the Korean education and the members of the Korean education systems, like the good teachers and very passionate parents and very diligent students.
This is very highly competitive. Do people really stand this, the psychological brunt of all this competition, or is it also Confucius rules that really help them to survive such great turbulence, if we may use. I mean, it's a very bumpy road.
That's true. And looking back upon my student days, like back in 1970s and 80s, of course, I was a very good student. I was a good student. At least I tried my best to study hard. And there is a saying among the Korean student: if you sleep more than 4 hours a day, you will fail the entrance examination to university. Of course, I slept, I think, 5 hours, but I was lucky enough to pass the entrance examination thanks to the
thanks
support
to
from
the
my
high
family.
IQ, of course. Since we are mentioning this, there was, I mean, this is not an issue. It's not. It's difficult to compare movies with real life. But the famous Korean movie Parasite was won an Oscar, and it was really admired by everybody who has seen the movie. I've seen the movie, and what attracted my attention that these vagabonds, or these people who wanted to act like a parasite in this successful family, actually they were qualified for the job. They did their share of education. So, for example, the father who pretended to be a driver was a good driver.
Mm-hmm.
And the wife who pretended to be a housewife or a cook was a good cook. Of course, they used a lot of illegitimate ways to reach their target.
Mm-hmm.
And even the boy who educated the girl was also a qualified teacher, or more or less talented teacher. So when we look at this, we find that even the vagabonds, or the bad people, were also educated to do this. So they did their homework, if we may use the expression. So this attracts our attention that they worked hard, even though that they couldn't find a way to be legitimate. So when they went a legitimate way, they were qualified for the characters that they have chosen.
Well, what an interpretation of the very famous movie.
Yeah,
I didn't notice there is such a kind of noble understanding of the movie, but I do agree with you. At least they did it. They did their best.
Yes, they did their jobs
to
the best. I mean, the guy, the driver, was stood the test of driving without a single dropping from the coffee.
Right, and also for his son.
Mm.
His son was actually failing
at the exam.
Every year at the exam,
mm.
but just because he has been preparing for the entrance examination for many years, his friend who introduced the job to him thought he is the best person who can teach the girl of the very rich family.
Yeah.
It's a very interesting story.
Yes.
Just because he studied for many years, he thought his friends in a poor condition might be the best teacher for the noble girl in the rich family.
So this is interesting about the education and the Korean education system. So when we look at the education system, this was helped us also to enlighten us about the aim of the country. For example, the country is the home of the UN Green Climate Fund.
Mm-hmm.
In the beginning, of course, Korea was interested in some of the heavy industries, and the heavy industries were producing, of course, a lot of pollution to the environment. And suddenly, Korea decided that it's going to go on green, and even leading UN Green Climate Fund and the leader in the low carbon green growth. How was that possible, and how can Korea help the developing countries in this field? Because we have seen a country that has invested heavily in heavy industry in the beginning of its industrial revolution, and then started getting on with clean environment, clean industry. And this is what we call a very good metamorphosis, if we use the expression.
Wow, what a question. This is very good question, and I think I'm not able to reply to your question in a very nice way, but I will try. Firstly, I'm very happy to see that today we have the new American president, Mr. Biden.
Yeah.
And one of the first exact orders he signed today was their willingness to go back to the Paris Climate Change Agreement. So I think we have a great potential for coming back to the wonderful international collaboration for that purpose. And definitely Korea is a part of the international collaboration for it. And as you rightly mentioned, Korea is the headquarter of the Global Climate Fund, which was established to help developing countries to be ready for the climate change initiative. And As far as I understand, in Songdo City, right next to the Incheon International Airport in Korea, there is the Secretariat of the Global Climate Fund. And as a kind of since we were greatly assisted by our friendly nation in the international society, we think it's now our turn to return what we have got from them back to them. So definitely climate change is one of the areas that we have to make greater efforts for being able to provide our experiences and our capabilities to our friendly nations in need. So that is one major reason for having the very headquarters of the fund of world. And also as far as I understand, the GCF, the very fund, launched its initial source resource mobilization in 2014, and they rapidly gathered practice worth of more than like $10 billion. And that's true. During the past economic development process, we had to focus on the, heavy industries, which like emits a lot of carbon, gases. And definitely in the all throughout the economic development process, we come to have a sharper recognition by our own people for the better life, in being able to enjoy fresh air. So we were sort of in a position to balance the industrial goal with the goal for people's daily life in terms of securing fresher air. So there was a great open national debate among the Korean people in the process of the Korea's economic development. And luckily enough, we were able to get the national consensus. So we are going in the direction for better living, conditions. Since we think we have achieved a certain level of economic growth, we think we'd better pay attention to like global issues like the climate change and also something related to rule of law and human rights. So all these kind of things, I think, require a serious debate, requiring what you call national consensus building. And luckily enough, so far we were successful in achieving that goal, and we are ready to also share our experience with our friendly nations in the world.
Since we're talking about the value of education, you have just mentioned the research and development projects that the policy of Korea as a government, as a nation, as human beings, is that they are investing as much as possible in research and development. And I know from some resources that Korea is the only country that has its own balance of imports and exports towards its side with China, because all the countries have the deficit on their side, and China is exporting to them more than they are importing, while you are exporting to China more than you are importing from it. Is this because the R&D and how you are developing very much the electronic industries, that you are the main exporters of electronic innovations to China, helping China to go on with its magnificent or mammoth economic rise?
That's true. Yes, Korea's annual trade volume is close to like $1 trillion, and half of which is export and half of which is in imports. And we have been exporting more to China than we import from
Which is
China.
very rare. It's almost the unique case.
Yes, of course, we are also providing some useful technology transfer to our Chinese counterparts. But these days, China is catching up with Korea and Japan at a very speedy, pace.
Almost light velocity.
And also, even though we provide like high technology to Chinese companies and making use of the very Korean technologies, they are making their final products coming out of such, borrowed technology from Korea. They are exporting back to Korea. So nobody knows what will happen. Yes, but we are very happy to be able to cooperate with our neighboring countries like China and Japan.
And I really find that very interesting, because this is how things are getting, I mean, very much dynamic. Because when there is no conflict of interest, history will go back to its books and to its academics, and people will get much more interested in the future of interests to find that, for example, China in 1950-53 was invading the South Korea and things like that, while things now are getting more into the economic cooperation, and the history is a page that has been turned. Right.
Indeed, China is the very, I mean, the I would say the very biggest trading partner to Korea at this moment. And also we do have many Korean companies who invested into the Chinese market, and they are producing Korean products in China to be exported to countries back to Korea and also to other countries in other regions. So our world is kind of an integrated society. So we are Koreans and they are Chinese, but we are, I would say, we are one people on the globe, on the same globe.
Yes, I believe that very much. And when we look at the history of China as a sort of a great influencer on the Far East, I mean, Japan was considered to be sort of its main heritage or its main cultural advance happened because of, in resonance to the Chinese culture and the Chinese imperial history back in the early 10th millennium, I mean, and before that. So when we go to the Republic of Korea ranks as high in the healthcare scale of the world. How was that possible? We'd like to hear much more about health and health system, but after the break, we're still here with His Excellency Ambassador Hong Jin-wook, the Ambassador of the Republic of Korea in Egypt, with a beautiful and great talk about the miracle or the Korean miracle. Stay tuned with us in the World of Info. So we're still listening with His Excellency Ambassador of Korea, Mr. Hong Jin-wook, and we are talking about healthcare system in Korea. This is very highly advanced, and I really admired your action during crisis, because the world has seen one of crises that we haven't seen since 1918 or 1917 epidemic. The epidemic of the Spanish flu started in 17, reached its peak in 18, and was devastating in 19, and then went down relaxing on 1920. But after 100 years, we had this crisis again with COVID-19, and all the countries really were stunned, and a lot of health facilities has failed, and a lot of people really failed, governments, which were of rich country, failed to act promptly with the COVID crisis. And in the middle of that, we see another phoenix from Korea coming up and rising and securing a complete control or trying of control on the COVID crisis. Could you tell us this experience, and was it because of the proper health care that you have invested in through the years, or it's because the Korean people are very much obedient to the system, or was it the technology that they were able to sort out and find out the people who are carrying the virus? Tell us about this, because a lot of people want to understand this, sir.
Dr. Malbrook, that question reminds me of the fact that you're a medical doctor.
Yes. And I'm a 24/7 physician. I only work in the radio 1 hour, because this is just an escape from the stress of surgery. I'm reading a lot, and so I find myself sharing this food for thought with you, sir.
Right, but again, I'm not an expert in this field. That is why I try to search, you know, every Korean government-related like website to be able to provide a kind of clue to the answer to your question. Korea is still under, I mean, the pandemic situation in Korea is still under, I mean, effective control. Although we were very much concerned about what we call a second wave of the pandemic, and we did suffer from a little bit of a second wave of the pandemic. However, now things are getting more and more stabilized with the number of infected patients per day less than like 400 every day. And we take the initiative of tracking and testing, to the end. So we are tracking all Korean people who want to be tested. We are tracking every Korean person who are
Has
related
encountered
to.
A COVID
Yes,
patient.
who are exposed to the COVID infection. So we are testing more than like I would say several thousand or tens of thousands per day. But
You made this innovation of the mobile going through the car,
definitely,
yes.
and thanks to the very efficient and effective social health system, which you right as you rightly mentioned, because we thanks to the very successful operation of the social health insurance system, we come to have a great database of people's health records. And of course, they are strictly under the confidentiality law, privacy law. But we are in a way, positioned to making use of all those accumulated data for, analyzing, every important information related to this kind of pandemics. And as you know, Koreans are very sensitive to the sense of equality in every important issues, and health and life is the most important issue to every Korean people. That is why Korean people became overwhelmingly, interested in the social health insurance system. And luckily enough, in the year 2000, we were able to like combine all the separate social health system into one single national plan. So there is only one payer, single payer in the social health insurance, meaning that government and also employer and employee, they are in a way they are under the compulsory obligation to pay their part for securing enough amount of money for providing decent medical services to people in need. And that is why since the year like 2000 or late 1990s, we come to have more and more provision of the nurses and doctors in hospitals. Since we have got the adequate amount of fund for those kind of medical services, we come to have more supply from the private medical sector, including the adequate supply of the number of doctors and nurses and hospitals. So all this kind of success in achieving a successful social health system, we were able to be equipped with a good database and good information sharing system so that we can raise the level of public awareness on the pandemic. And also, people are not worried about being treated in hospital. They don't worry about the cost because all of the important major medical fees, including medical checkups and even including like cancer treatment,
Is in the insurance.
yeah, they're insured by the National Social Health Plan, so they don't worry about it. They are ready to in a way discuss with their government and their public institution about their health condition. All these kind of things made people think that we should have a like trust upon the capabilities of the society or the government. So they have shown great perseverance, and they have shown their great patience to the initiative taken by the Korean government to take control of the pandemic. So we are still suffering, and we shouldn't be complacent. But I think Korean people are, in a way, confident that they will overcome this pandemic crisis too.
So what about the vaccination? Are you having a vaccination system, and what type of vaccines are you using? Is it the live attenuated like the Chinese one, or the synthetically new types that have been made in the West?
Yes, we are open to any kind of collaboration from our international partners, while we are also trying to invent our own vaccine. Mm-hmm. Korea is also has a good
pharmaceutical industry.
Yes, mm-hmm. indeed. So, but our government is trying to make contracts with some major Western, you know, pharmaceutical companies like Pfizer and AstraZeneca.
And, so, did you start the national scheme of vaccination or not?
Not yet. We have made a couple of contract with the companies, and we are right before, like, verifying some of those products. We need to make contracts while we, like, officially recognize the effectiveness of the vaccine before, providing those vaccines to our people. Mm-hmm. So all these kind of things are happening at the same time.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So we have, according to the announcement by the Korean government, we have secured like around 76 million doses of vaccines for the Korean people. But we are yet to wait for the official recognition by the Korean government of the effectiveness of all those vaccines. Mm.
So when we're talking about the population, the current population of Korea, it's 76 million now?
Almost 52 million, South
52,
Korea.
52 million, yes.
Including North Korea, it comes to like 76 million.
Yes, that's what I wanted to say. I mean, that was a tricky question, but...
you got it.
So, when we are talking about that, then we have to talk about more things to do. I think a lot of interesting talk with His Excellency Ambassador Hong Jing Wook, Ambassador of Korea in Cairo. Stay tuned with us. We're coming live from Radio Cairo, World of Info. More to talk about the Republic of Korea after the break. Listening to the World of Info, and today our distinguished guest, Ambassador Hong Jing Wook, Ambassador of Korea, of the Republic of Korea in Cairo. And we'd like to talk about the fact that the Republic of Korea is ranking as the first in the world as the most innovative country. And this is a very prestigious prize, if I may use the expression, because innovation is the key of success. If a country is not an imitator and it's producing high-tech things, this is really very much advanced. How was that possible? Is it because of the education, or because the government is investing in R&D, or how are you able to modify the wills of the students to try to innovate? I mean, sometimes the closed education system, people who are much interested to succeed, as you have mentioned in an exam, could become going in a queue without having to think out of the box while actually they are doing that. How are you able to balance the continuous education and the challenging exams into support of innovation and excelling in it?
I think, Dr. Mapur, you have already touched upon the major part of my answers to your question, so I don't need to repeat it. But South Korea took the second spot in the 2020 Bloomberg Global Innovation Index, and Korea has been in the top three for the last 9 consecutive years since 2012. And as you may be aware, the Bloomberg Innovation Index evaluates countries using like 7 kinds of different, you know, criterions. And well, in brief, so in addition to the very kind and explanation by Dr. Mabrook to his own question, I'd like to say just one thing. Korean people like everything new. We like everything new. And we we have a kind of very insistent willingness to look for something new and something better.
Mm-hmm.
And that is well also supported by, as you rightly mentioned, heavy investment in the education and in the research and development opportunities, as I already told you. So that is the very, I think, the secret of the continuous successful innovation story of the Korean people. And that is well reflected in the success stories of the Korean electronics field. Mm-hmm. Korea is a leading nation in the ICT sector. And ICT is what? It's the very effective tool for innovation, not only in the people's life, but also in the what you call e-government. So yes, that's not a secret, but a secret of Korea's success in the what you call innovation. And don't forget about this fact: Korea likes everything new and everything better.
So this will bring us to the important question, which is this is the most important job that you are doing here in Cairo, which is improvement of and working on improvement of the Egyptian-Korean relations with your counterpart, Dr. Hazem Fahmy, the Egyptian ambassador.
I like him.
Yes, he's a personal friend, as you know, of course, right. And his work in your counterpart working in Korea, and as the Egyptian ambassador to Korea. You have a very great burden on your shoulders, both of your shoulders, because Egypt and Korea have had very strong ties and friendship, friendly relations. And nowadays, friendly relations are not just in politics, but its main task and its main burden and its main backbone is economic cooperation.
Indeed.
Tell us about this unique Egyptian-Korean relation.
Mm-hmm. Well, during the last 6 months since my arrival back in early July, even regardless of the pandemic, I was lucky enough to be able to meet with many Egyptian people, and not only in the government but also in the private sectors, including business. And also I was able to visit some regional governories, including Benisue, where we have Samsung factories in Korea, Egypt Technological Universities, and I was able to travel down to Aswan and Abu Simbel. And they say I was the first foreign ambassador who visited Aswan since the outbreak of the pandemic.
Oh.
I feel honored.
Yes, of course. We are honored that you made this visit, and we are very proud that you took the initiative during these hard times to support the Egyptian tourism industry and exploratory industry as well.
I'd love to. And many more Koreans are ready to be able to visit this great country full of wonderful natural landscaping, full of wonderful cultural heritage. Mm. And going back to your question, through those kind of meetings and visits, I once again realized the importance of my mission as the Korean ambassador here, to upgrade the level of our bilateral relation to a renewed one, renewed in a more heightened one. Thanks to the very successful visit by the President al-Sisi to Korea in the year 2016, we were able to adopt what they call comprehensive cooperate partnership between our two countries, and that is why we have been expanding the scope of our cooperation into various kind of new fields, including medical cooperation. Also, we do have a wonderful cooperation in education, and also we are now currently discussing with the Egyptian counterpart on initiating a kind of joint study on the feasibility of a possible free trade agreement, or in other words, economic partnership agreement, where we can devise ways of boosting not only trade but also investment.
Mm-hmm.
So in brief, we are deepening and we are expanding the scope of our bilateral cooperation. That's certainly on the basis of the very comprehensive cooperative partnership that we were able to adopt at the time of President Al-Sisi visit to Korea. Mm-hmm. And we are actually preparing for a postponed visit by the Korean president to visit Egypt. He was mm-hmm. supposed to come here last March, but
unfortunately,
due to the pandemic. And when I was getting the accreditation from my president, Korean President Moon Jae-in, he once again, reiterated his serious willingness to come to this great country to continue the discussion with his Egyptian counterpart on how to upgrade the bilateral relations. The two presidents, they had already two rounds of phone conversation on last year. They reiterated the importance of meeting face-to-face to each other once again. So, of course, I can refer many important figures, like the annual trade volume between our two countries reaching to $2 billion per year. Mm. And we have more than 170 Korean companies operating here in Egypt. Mm. And we have invested more than $600 million in Samsung Electronics, LG Electronics, and a couple of Korean textile companies. Mm. They are employing more than 5,000 Egyptian people for the production of the collaborated products. And we are, just for example, the Samsung and LG Electronics, they are exporting annually close to $700 million to other countries in the region, which amounts to 90% of the total Egyptian exports to other countries in terms of the electronics industry field.
Mm-hmm.
So, as you rightly mentioned, our strong relation going back to the time of adopting what I call Cairo Declaration in the year 1943.
Yes,
it started in the politics, but now we are enjoying wider collaboration in various kinds of diverse kinds of fields, including trade and investment.
It's very strange that in Cairo 1943 declaration, mm-hmm. neither Korea nor Egypt were members in this declaration or even signatories on it.
Mm-hmm.
But what bonds us is not just the declaration, but bonds us is the strong relation that comes in mutual respect between both of our countries.
Exactly.
And I believe that the cooperation we had once, and I think it's going still on without mentioning the name of the company, also car investment, car mm-hmm. industry companies going here mm-hmm. in Korea. And I believe this will still go on. Are you interested more in since you are in the green climate control treaties, are you interested as well in user-friendly or electric cars, mm-hmm. which are environmental friendly? Are there initiative in Korea to change some of these factories, car factories, the mammoth car factories, into other branches in this field?
That's right. Of course, domestically, we are trying our best to develop our production facilities of the, low carbon vehicles, including the electric ones. We have prepared many kind of incentives schemes to stimulate the Korean business sector to pay more attention to the very new area of producing electric vehicles. Mm. And we have been also discussing with some foreign partners, possibly with Egypt. We have been checked the possibility of the bilateral collaboration in this field too,
yes.
between Egypt and Korea.
Mm.
And I know at this moment Egypt is cooperating with their Chinese counterparts.
Yes.
In,
but still, it's a very open, promising market.
Definitely.
There will always be a place for the Korean industries.
What's happening here in Egypt, and I don't rule out further collaboration between Korea and Egypt in terms of the
That's why, because this stimulated me when I read about what Nasr factory is signing a treaty or an agreement about the electric cars with a Chinese company or the Chinese government. I believe also there's definitely a place for Korean investment in this field as well. It's a wide market, and it could be like we're exporting televisions. We can be export Korean cars built in Egypt for the region or for Africa.
That's exactly true.
Excellency, really, I think time has flied. Time flies, yes. Because we were having a very interesting talk with His Excellency, Ambassador Hong Jin-wook, the Ambassador of Republic of Korea, such a friendly country, innovative country, and a dear friend of Egypt. And His Excellency has been here for 6 months, and I want you to promise us that you will come back again to tell us more about your experience in Egypt.
If allowed.
Of course, it'd be a pleasure and honor. Sir, thank you very much to come and honor us with your presence and with your informative talk about Korea and Korean-Egyptian relations. And we're looking forward to have you once again soon, inshallah.
Honor and pleasure is mine.
Sir, it was a great pleasure. This was World of Info. My name is Dr. Amr Mabrouk. Dua Muhammad was at the control. See you next time, same station from Radio Cairo, and stay safe.
Fun. 95.4 FM. Cairo.